talking about a master plan for a city or a big land mass of 50,000 or 100,000 hectares is absolutely futile. It has to be at the city level, and city in the Indian parlance is something which has a population of over 10,000 people. So if a 10,000 people city is likely to go up to 15 or 20, you see, the trigger could be one small economic activity, a setup of an industrial unit suddenly brings in about 25,000 people into that city. So the city has to plan for itself, and I don't think the master plan for a state or a bigger landmass becomes an academic exercise. The existing land acquisition bill was created in 1894 by the Britishers, right? And they had brought in clauses like the doctrine of eminent domain, etc., wherein the government had unhindered, unbridled powers to acquire any land that they wanted. Of course, post-independence, a series of amendments or improvements have happened in the bill, but the skeleton or the spine of the bill was written in 1894. So, in most respects, it is redundant and it is not contemporary, or it does not take into account the realities of today. Now, 2011, about in August or so, the Land Acquisition, Resettlement and Rehabilitation Bill was released into the public domain for consultations. It has gone through a series of consultations, and hopefully this winter session it will be presented in the Parliament for notification, and the Cabinet has already debated about it, and you know, the group of ministers, the you know, it has also gone through Parliamentary Standing Committee, etc. So that process is done. So now the issue is that once the bill is passed, then the applicability of it has to be seen. While most debates are centered around housing and dwelling units, there is on a 1 acre, not more than 50 to 55% can be developed. The rest are open areas, circulation, water, parks, things like that. So land is the most critical element. So while the private sector keeps talking about their bit of 55%, the 45% either has to be developed by the government or is our existing water bodies and parks on land. So as sustainability is concerned, theoretically, it is easy to integrate all these elements, the water, the power, but it's, to my mind, it's more of a planning issue, whether it's urban planning or design from the architecture standpoint. And through this interview, let me also break the myth that there is a difference in the cost if we talk about sustainable projects. If at best, the cost markup will not go beyond 10%, which the end occupier user is willing to pay, because it does not have a degenerative effect, and rather the power and other consumption comes down, and then it's self-paying in the cost. Everybody talks about in terms of the P's of market, product price and place and promotion, but one thing that I feel that the industry should and hopefully would evolve is good people. We have an acute dearth of quality people as far as this industry is concerned. Not really talking only about the implementation level, even at the creative level, which could include the second generation entrepreneurs, it could include architects and planners, it could include masons and workers at the shop floor level. Mm-hmm. But the first thing that I see as a change is better people entering the business. Two is with the advent of technology, a better infusion of technology should happen in the construction methodology as well as in the planning. And third, good clean money. The industry, although is $100 billion plus, there is a big shortfall of most funding or infusion of money into this industry is mezzanine or debt, or more like bridge funding. But we need strong capital which can be exposed for a longer tenure in the industry. So these are the three things which I think should take our industry to the next level.